Any thoughts on collaborating with Stephen Wilson? We have, of course, because he was on stage with me at the Shepherd's Bush Empire doing Shadow of the Hierophant. I also played on, I think the album was called, is it Grace for Drowning? Yeah, I think Stephen's very, very gifted, very dedicated. He's younger than me, damn it. But hey, you know, it's nice to have been an influence on him because he's a very bright guy. I love the art direction of your albums, from Beyond the Shroud to The Risen. There seems to be a pattern in terms of photography and the style, font of the title of the album. Is this a deliberate thing? Sleeves that have been shot by the same photographer. No, so Harry Pierce, the designer, he did the cover. So that was a photograph of a temple just as the light was coming up. I'm trying to remember where he was at the time. He might have been in Bali or somewhere in Indonesia. When he comes up with the writing, the font tends to like to have very understated writing. So for quite a number of albums, we've had that. In recent years, it's been Maurizio and Angela Vicidomini, and their husband and wife team are photographers, who indeed have done, you know, the cover for this one and several others that we've done. So there is a consistency there. I think it's from using the same team, but the team sometimes shifts. Would you consider playing Twilight Ale House as part of the set? Well, now it's a funny thing you should say that. If I was going to play it as part of a set, it's something that I haven't played really since the very early 70s. The best way to relearn something is to re-record it. Then it's cast in stone. Now, I think that Twilight Ale House, this might be sacrilege for the converted or the devotees, but I think it was an underdeveloped song, which is why it didn't end up on any album at the time. So it's a kind of Genesis anomaly. Funny enough, Jacko Jacksic said to me, how about doing that one? So I think that if I was to ever do a Genesis Revisited number 3, it could be part of that. I'm not saying I will, but if I ever did, it could be part of that and it might well work. Do you play classical guitar on this record? Just about every album that I've ever done under my own name, I tend to have a piece that is just classical guitar. But on this record, I thought I wanted to keep the pace up and I wanted to do something that people would say, yep, that's a rock record, but rock in its broadest sense of the word. So there are moments of nylon guitar, but they're in for brief cameos. And so it's not as if I'm going into that siesta moment. I don't give people long enough to fall asleep. I wanted to keep the audience fully awake and engaged from beginning to end. So to give the pace of the journey more speed. However, the next record I do may well be an album of classical guitar, or at least pieces written upon a classical guitar. Like you, I do like to travel and explore. I was also enchanted when visiting Petra, visited the library and wandered into the desert. Is this atmosphere, stroke experience, somehow present on your new album? Yes. Often what happens is I know I'm going to visit somewhere, and I start to dream about it before I actually visit it, and I've maybe seen it in film. After having written and recorded something, you visit the actual place that was the inspiration, and it just reconfirms everything that you felt about it. So having visited Jordan, the star of the show was the desert itself. That's the big thing. Now we know that deserts are big, hot, unfriendly places, but they also have a tremendous magic and they weave that magic upon you. So Petra, of course, is carved out of rock, so it's unique. I think I don't think anywhere else in the world have I come across anything quite like that. There's something about the desert that lives, and I try and embody that in song very much, sometimes with the sound of the distant ghostly guitar. I'm wondering if you're aware of the visual impact of your performance and do you have it in mind when making an album? To be a band in the early days where you didn't carry your own light show or your own lighting designer, as people do now, meant that you were at the mercy of whatever was available on that stage, whether that was one red light bulb or a strobe or oil lights that they used to fire at you. During the most delicate sections of music, you could have something hugely inappropriate. There'd be no conversation between light and sound, whereas now we do have that conversation with our lighting guys, and it can make a huge difference if your lighting man knows the music. At some point, you've got to hand it over to a professional and say, I trust you to do an amazing light show here. When we first had a light show with Genesis, back in the day, we were rehearsing at a place in Brixton, and I was watching the effect of black light interacting the UV stuff, and it looked like you were looking at the band behind a screen of light, and it made it look as if you were watching famous people on television. They or we indeed just looked different. But if you get it right, it can be a very, very powerful combination. What distinguishes the new album from past studio efforts like The Night Siren and Wolflight? I adore this album. I think it's the best thing I've ever done. Mind you, I felt the same thing when I'd done Spectral Mornings. I thought, it's the best thing I've ever done. When we did Selling England by the Pound with Genesis, I thought, it's the best thing I've ever done. But I suppose the difference is I feel perhaps more confident of this than anything I've ever done. If it becomes a number one record, I won't be surprised. And if it doesn't, I won't cry, but I shall just reapply myself. I shall get back on the horse. So for me, I absolutely love it. It's kind of my own personal Sergeant Pepper. Yeah, I think my stuff probably doesn't get any better than this. So if you don't like this, you're not going to really like anything I've ever done. Did you use the electric dulcimer on your latest recording? Unfortunately, no. Although I would like to, because I had a hard time finishing this album in time. We were working at some rate to bring it in, so I was having to think very, very fast, and I couldn't always access an extraordinary amount of equipment, much of which is you know, in store. I want everything I've got to be on the next album, so if it does become a number one, it'll be, yeah, you know, I can do the hell what I like on this one. What do you do when you experience a bit of writer's block? How do you pull yourself out of a creative funk when lyrical ideas or melodies aren't coming to you? What I used to do was fuss and fret about it and force myself to write something. I no longer think like that. I think that, no, inspiration will come. I will work on a number of tracks at any one particular time, and as each one reveals itself in a less than chronological way, when the muse does alight, I allow myself to write very quickly. You know, to ride that good wave when it comes in is all important. Are you still planning on writing your autobiography? If so, any idea when it will be published? Yes, I am currently working on the autobiography, and I hope to have it finished soon. What guitar effects do you think you'll try to incorporate in the future? Like most rock guitarists, I'm always looking for this sound that has quite a lot of upper harmonic in it that informs both the bass strings as well as the top strings. It's something that has a kind of vocal quality to it, the ah quality, the ah, there's a kind of vowel sound that goes with it. I tend to work these days less with guitar synthesizers, although I like to think that I pioneered that quite a bit in the early years. I want to be able to recognize piano as piano, and I want to be able to recognize guitar as guitar. So I tend to work with the original sound source and think, how can we manipulate it after the event? I mean, I've just bought a Mesa Boogie amp, for instance, and I love the sound of that. But you know, the effects I've been using have been very much within the computer.